Good morning, Strasburg United Methodist Church, and welcome to worship. Today is September 10th, 2023. Will you join me as we open in prayer this morning? Almighty God, whose ways are far beyond our understanding, help us to trust your judgments so that we may do your will by loving you and one another. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary. Prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
It is time now for our prayers for the people. Will you pray with me now? All-knowing God, you know our needs before we name them in prayer. All-caring God, you care enough to hear our prayers anyway, knowing that all we truly need is your love. All-loving God, hear now these prayers that name the needs of your people. O Lord, we pray today for your people who need health. We pray for your people who need peace. We pray for people who need hope. We pray for your people who need blessing. Your whole creation needs your powerful presence. O all-powerful God, the need is so great. We rejoice that you are greater. Hear these prayers we offer in Jesus' name. Amen. And now will you join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Will you join me now in our prayer for illumination? Holy Spirit, as your word is read and preached, pass among your gathered people, opening minds to increase understanding, opening hearts to bind us together in your love. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Our scripture today comes from Exodus, the second book of the Bible, as we continue to hear the story of Moses this morning. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. In 2016, American scientists wrote in the journal Nature that it appears that human beings have an upper limit when it comes to age. Scientists looked at mortality data from the world's richest countries and determined that 115 years of age seems to be the oldest that any of us can hope to achieve. Only 1 in 10,000 of us will make it that far. If you were to take the 4 million kindergartners currently enrolled in the United States, and these are our children born in 2018, only 400 of them will make it to 115 years of age. Of course, there are outliers, but the last one to make it over 120 years old was a 122-year-old who died in 1997. Of course, a maximum limit is not the same as an average lifespan. A man will live to be about 76, and a woman 81 here in the United States. And those numbers have gone down in the last few years, especially as COVID-19 and as our lifestyles have changed. Christopher Bullock, the author of the 1716 book, The Cobbler of Preston, once wrote, "'Tis impossible to insure of anything but death and taxes." It was a quote later made famous in the writings of Benjamin Franklin in 1789. Now, the joke, of course, is about taxes, but the truth is about death. We are all going to die. You are all going to die. I'm going to die. And yet many of us act as if we aren't going to. We ignore warning signs of health. We don't write our wills or buy life insurance or even plan for our death when it will one day come, and we leave a mess behind for our descendants. We don't talk to our spouses or our friends about our wishes or dreams for them after death comes to us, and many of us should. Too often we only think about death when we come to a funeral, and then 20 minutes or 40 minutes or a couple hours later we are ready to eat, drink, and try to be merry as we work through our grief in this ritual of a funeral meal. We hold off on major decisions as if we have all the time in the world to make them. Now, tomorrow marks the 22nd anniversary of terrorist attacks of September 11th, 2001. People in New York, Virginia, and Pennsylvania were the victims who lost their lives that day. Many of them thought they had all the time in the world. This week, I'm continuing the story of Moses as we explore the different seasons of life that God has created. Last week, we heard about that Moses had heard the call of God to free the people of Israel. Remember, there was a burning bush. And so Moses goes to Egypt. Moses confronts the Pharaoh. He tells the Pharaoh to let his people go. But in the wonderful language of the Old Testament, Pharaoh hardens his heart. Pharaoh is a stubborn man who doesn't want his slave labor to disappear. And so Moses promises that God will send down 10 plagues to change the Pharaoh's mind. First, the water of the Nile and in the groundwater is turned into blood. Second, there is a plague of frogs that falls from the sky. Third, lice attacks everyone. The fourth plague is about wild animals and flies that infest Egypt. Fifth, livestock begin to fall ill and die. The sixth plague, animals and human beings are given painful sores called boils. Seventh, thunderstorms bring down deadly hail. Eighth, the locusts come and eat all the crops. Ninth, a deep darkness comes, a darkness that cannot be driven back by any light, including firelight or moonlight or starlight. For 3 days, the darkness covers the land. But you know what? Nothing changes. The Pharaoh does not relent in the midst of all these supernatural signs. And so the final plague comes, a plague that will only spare the faithful. Moses promises that the firstborn of all animals and all the Egyptians will die. Moses educates his people in the way of Passover. They slaughter a lamb, they smear the blood on the doorframe, they eat unleavened bread and fire-roasted lamb and wear their shoes and clothes and they hold their staff so they can flee at a moment's notice. It is called Passover, as the angel of death will pass over the houses of those who have been marked by God. Now, we often don't know when death will come into our lives, but Moses, by God's direction, can tell the people of Egypt and the Hebrews that death is coming that very night. After the devastation of death, including the death of Pharaoh's firstborn son, the Hebrews are able to begin their exodus out of Egypt, their escape from slavery. Now, I don't know about you, but this is one of those troublesome texts we hear from the Bible, isn't it? God, the angry God, coming down to smite people down. If God is such a loving and just God, why would God cause people to die? What about those innocent firstborn babies? What about the animals that provide prosperity and livelihood to people? Think about the firstborn in your own lives. Now, in my own family, only Gabriel would be left. You see, I'm a firstborn child. My wife is a firstborn child. And Wesley, our oldest son, is a firstborn child. Even my mother-in-law, Becky, and my father-in-law, Wesley, are firstborn children in their family. My mom, Robin, was a firstborn child. And my dad, John, was an only child. So the devastation that would be wrought by that loss would be devastating to the one who was left for Gabriel. Now there's an explanation given to us in verse 12 of Exodus, chapter 12, as the final plague is announced. God said to Moses, "I will bring judgment to all the gods of Egypt." You see, the 10 plagues are a direct attack on the false gods that the people put their faith in. Animals, material goods, even the cycles of flood and drought in the Nile would be put in their natural place. Even the concept of immortality would be tested as the firstborn children would all die, leaving behind a nation grieving the loss of their natural leaders, you know, those who would inherit the most. But maybe it's not all that complicated. Maybe this story isn't a reminder that death comes and that we have no power in the face of death. Despite all of our attempts to become like God or to make all of humanity a god, We can do nothing except respond with faith to the unseen and powerful God. We are all going to die. You're going to die. I'm going to die. And nothing we can do can change that reality. So what do we do in response to this part of life, to this season called death? How do we as Christians face death? Well, first, we admit that we will die one day. Secondly, we turn to the Bible. In 1 Corinthians 15 and the Gospel of John chapter 14, we have words, and they're some of the two best chapters that we turn to about resurrection and the promises that God makes to us as Christians. Now third, as we face death, we weep. John chapter 11, Lamentations 1, Jeremiah 31 are just some great verses to look at. You see, Jesus wept for Lazarus in the Gospel of John. The Israelites wept for the broken relationship between God and his followers in Lamentations. God weeps for his people in Jeremiah. And grief is an appropriate response to death. And we do not have to fear death. We should not fear death. I believe that the reason we don't talk about death so much in our families or with our loved ones, or even think about it in our personal lives, is that we are afraid of losing life. We fear aging because our dreams disappear. We mourn what could have been. But then as we get older, sometimes we begin to fear the unknown. Fortunately, our faith has taught us that there is something beyond us. Paul writes about it in 1 Corinthians 15 as he says that death is not the end because we have the promise of resurrection. There will be times when life is hard, we know that. And there may even be times that we desire death to take us away from pain or difficulty. But the question arises, should we actually seek an end to our life? Now there are those in Christianity who will say that suicide is a mortal sin that will forever separate us from God. I'm not one who believes that. You see, instead I believe that God will search our heart and we will have to account for our actions in this life and the effects that our lives and choices have on others. But I also believe in God's infinite grace and wisdom and that God will understand our motivations and our struggles and give us peace. But if you are someone who is thinking about the end, and if you are someone who believes in Christ, take heart in the words of Paul, who once suffered in prison at the hands of the Roman authorities. He wrote to the Philippians these words, "I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and to be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you." Paul continues to write that even in his suffering, he has purpose. And that purpose is to share the love of Christ with those to whom God has called him to speak. The truth that I know is that we should not seek death to escape suffering, because we are never sure how our suffering will be a witness to others. Perhaps our struggles with long-term illness will bring a son or daughter to God. Maybe our pain will allow us to believe even more fiercely in a loving God. Next, I think we should take the advice that Paul gave to the Corinthians in one of his first letters. He says, "We rejoice with those who rejoice, and we mourn with those who mourn." Finally, when we do come to the time of our death, do not be afraid. Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, gathered his disciples together, and he blessed them. And according to the Gospel of John, Jesus spoke to them for hours, trying to prepare them for the time when he would no longer be with them. We can do the same with those we love. We can teach our children about the frailty of life. Part of the hazard of being a pastor is going to a lot of funerals and maybe even conducting a lot of them. And my children, they pick up on the grief of families and the grief that I have. It has turned into a learning experience for them as they understand that death is a natural part of life. It is just another season that we have to go through. And if this advice isn't enough, would you remember with me the prayer that we often say in our funerals? Remember the words of wisdom written by people of faith who have long departed from us. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in our life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Now, if you live to 115 years old, be amazed and be thankful. If we had that lifetime, we would have our heart beat over 4.8 million times. We would celebrate over 42,000 sunrises and sunsets. We would witness over 1,400 full moons. But you know what? Life is more than a formula of heartbeats beaten and sunrises shining. Life is about the love that we share with others. And it's about the love that we receive from God, the forgiveness that we have received, and the way that we share that love and forgiveness with our friends, our family, and to ourselves. Do not be afraid, for God is with you. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace forever. The Lord be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace, and give you peace, and give you peace forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and give you